knows a lot about all kinds of stuff. Professor Dave explains.
After Aristotle's first official establishment of logic, it was not surprising that the first developments came from the Peripatetics themselves, his students and followers. Theophrastus of Eresus and Eudemus of Rhodes were the main contributors, publishing more on the subject than Aristotle himself. However, much like several others in this period, very few fragments remain, with most records coming from posterior commentators. These two figures simplified and improved several minor aspects of Aristotle's logic, especially his modal theory, by clarifying the roles of different degrees of contingency. For example, that possibility is weaker than actuality, which is weaker than necessity, and that a conclusion can only be as strong as the weaker of them in the premises. Besides developing a few short-lived new forms of argument, they were the first to propose what would become the modus ponens and modus tollens in logic. Here are examples of each. If Dave is human, then he is mortal. Dave is human, thus Dave is mortal. And, if YouTube is human, then it is mortal. YouTube is not mortal, thus YouTube is not human. These are simple conditional syllogisms where the subject and predicate become antecedent and consequent, and the only new information in the second premise is either affirming the antecedent or in denial of the consequent. So the structure of a modus ponens would be if A, then B. A, then B. And a modus tollens, if A, then B. Not B, then not A. Pyrrhonism also veered somewhat into logic as they developed a criticism of deduction and induction while arguing that affirmations of knowledge can be neither true nor false. They criticized judgments of knowledge by reducing all possible justification or basis for truth or falsity to fallible methods in any form of argument. Agrippa, a famous Pyrrhonist, proposed 5 modes of knowledge justification, developed afterwards in a trilemma, or an argument presenting 3 alternatives in the premises. This would be the basis for most epistemological analyses, as theories establish the basis for knowledge either 1. As unquestionable dogmas or axioms, serving as a base to build all knowledge, known today as foundationalism, 2. As a circular relationship between truths supporting each other, known today as coherentism, or 3. As a series of regressions where one truth is the basis for another, and so on indefinitely, known as infinite regress. Here is an example to lend some context. Consider the phrase, "The word of God is the Bible." First, according to foundationalism, you can't ask why for this proposition, because it is, from a religious perspective, true in itself. If you are a Pyrrhonian skeptic, you will ask why. The lack of answer from dogmatists will make this proposition unjustified, and therefore neither true nor false for our inquirer. Second, for coherentism, this proposition is circular in a vicious manner because it incorporates the concept that it is trying to prove. Because the Bible says that God exists, God can make the Bible the word of God. This doesn't act as firm justification. Lastly, considering the infinite regress, we can point to the fact that if anyone wants to justify the existence of God, this will need another justification, which will need another one, and another, and so forth. Given that we can't explore all possible justifications for any statement, we can't take its truth or falsity at face value. Agrippa's trilemma can help us identify fallacious forms of argumentation in rhetorical or theological babblings, and it also ties in with what we saw in the previous tutorial about Pyrrhonism, given that using this method is a path to suspend one's judgments. Thus, for them, this recognition would compromise any attempt to assert the truth or falsity of any proposition, although several philosophers still defend some version of these formulations to this day. Interestingly, Sextus recognized the issue of using arguments to criticize arguments, but compared his to a purgative medicine, which eliminates itself as well as the bodily fluids it intends to. This was similar to Ludwig Wittgenstein's first perspective of philosophy some 1750 years later. The rather unknown dialectician school, risen from the Platonic and Eleatic mixed Megarian school, also developed a few notions of logic that were quite advanced for their time. They treated propositions as a whole instead of Aristotle's term logic as being crucial in the development of propositional logic. Thus, instead of operators, it was the proposition itself that defined its mode, if necessary or possible, or the negative of both, depending on how it was phrased. Another relevant development was a theory of meaning, where everything said had only one correct interpretation according to the intention of the speaker, and ambiguity only existed with intentionally obscuring speech, a prototypical formulation of what would only recently become the speech acts theory by Austin. However, this also rendered their analysis of validation problematic, as what is said is the actual, and thus counterintuitively only the actual is possible. To prove this, they developed the first and weakest version of the master argument, an important logical topic in antiquity, which summarily posited that 1. Past truth is always necessary, 2. The impossible does not follow from the possible, and 3. Something is possible which neither is nor will be true. Zeno of Citium, founder of the Stoics, studied with the dialectician Diodorus and eagerly wrote on logical topics as well as the master argument with his successor Cleanthes, but produced nothing too original. Chrysippus of Soli, Cleanthes' successor, however, is said to be the second greatest logician in the history of logic itself, with a lasting impact on several branches of logic. Much like the dialecticians, their logical inquiry also encompassed epistemology and philosophy of language. Reason played a great role in asserting the truth of an argument, and true knowledge could only arise from the conviction of a sage altogether with the verification of their peers and general consensus. Logic, then, was the study of the functioning of reason itself. Propositional logic was further developed, and similarly to the peripatetic systematization of conditional propositions, premises were called antecedent and the conclusion consequent. Their subject matter in logic was the sayable, a meaning beyond what is said or written, much like the dialectician's speech acts. A single premise, then, would be a complete sayable, as its meaning would be contained in itself, while an incomplete one required further questioning for its completion, or what we would call an isolated predicate. They were also the first to propose complex propositions. While Aristotle focused on terms and the form of a syllogism, the Stoics focused on how propositions could interact with one another via different connectives, which allowed them to surpass his teachings. By treating a proposition as a variable, much like predicates and subjects in term logic, one could further develop systems to verify them. To be valid, again, inspired by the peripatetics and the dialecticians, any combination of arguments should be reducible to the 5 indemonstrables, or most basic argument forms. The first two are the modus ponens and modus tollens, as we have previously seen, where P and Q are complete sayables, or propositions. They are followed then by: it is not the case that both P and Q, P, therefore not Q, and then either P or Q, P, therefore not Q, and finally either P or Q, not P, therefore Q. Thus, all propositions would be true or false, even those that were possible but did not happen. This would then also be a response to the master argument, where Cleanthes would defend that past truth was not necessary, and Chrysippus would deny that what is impossible does not follow from what is possible, as there is no motion without a cause, and thus not everything is true or false. As their 5 indemonstrables attempt to prove, that is not the case, and thus everything that exists would have a necessary causal relationship with other things, what would be called a causal determinism. This is consonant with the overall Stoic position that through reason one can know everything, for if something was neither true nor false, it would be unknowable. In contrast with contemporary interpretations of speech acts and propositional logic, as well as other logical theories of the time, similar utterances in different moments refer to the same sayables for the Stoics, and truthfulness may change according to its context. The width of the subjects in which the Stoics, and especially Chrysippus, delved into, improving logic to an extent never even imagined by Aristotle, is far beyond the scope of this series. But hopefully, the role of the Stoics and their contemporaries in the development of logic is now a bit more apparent. Now let's move forward and take a look at the medieval period in philosophy.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.